In this video, I will read the conversation between Nora and Kjellstedt, and depending on page 73 until 77. Keep stay watching. And you naturally did so at once, because 5 or 6 days after work, you brought me the bond with your father's signature, and then I gave you the money. Well, haven't I been paying it off regularly? Fairly so, yes. But to come back to the matter in hand, that must have been a very trying time for you, Mrs. Helmer. It was in the... Your father was very ill, wasn't he? He was very near his end. And died soon afterward. Yes. Tell me, Mrs. Helmer, can you by any chance remember what day your father died? On what day of the month, I mean? Papa died on the 29th of September. That is correct. I have ascertained it for myself. And as that is so, there is a discrepancy which I cannot account for. What discrepancy? I don't know. The discrepancy consists, Mrs. Helmer, in the fact that your father signed this bond 3 days after he died. What do you mean? I don't understand. Your father died on the 29th of September, but look here. Your father has died his signature the 2nd of October. It is a discrepancy, isn't it? Can you explain it to me? It is a remarkable thing, too, that the word 2nd of October, as well as the years, are not written in your father's handwriting, but in one that I think I know. Well, of course, it can be explained your father may have forgotten to date his signature, and someone else may have dated it haphazard before they know of his date. There is no harm in that. It all depends on the signature of the names, and that is Gian Niu, I suppose, Mrs. Helmer? It was your dear himself who signed his name here. No, it was not. It was I that wrote Papa's name. Are you aware that is a dangerous confession? In what way? You shall have your money, son. Okay, let me ask you a question. Why did you not send the paper to your father? It was impossible. Papa was so ill. If I had asked him for his signature, I should have had to tell him what the money was to be used for. And when he was so ill himself, I couldn't tell him that my husband's life was in danger. It was impossible. It would have been better for you if you had given up your trip abroad. No, that was impossible. The trip was to save my husband's life. I couldn't give that up. But did it never occur to you that you were committing a fraud on me? I couldn't take that into account. I didn't trouble myself about you at all. I couldn't bear you because you put so many heartless difficulties in my way. Although, you know, what a dangerous condition my husband was in. Mrs. Helmer, you evidently do not realize fully what it is that you have been guilty of, but I can assure you that my one small step, which lost me all my reputation, was nothing more or nothing worse than what you have done. You? Do you ask me to believe that you were brave enough to run a risk to save your wife's life? The law cares nothing about motives. Then it must be a very foolish law. Foolish or not, it is the law by which you will be judged. If I produce this paper in court,